If you fancy getting away from it all, Bar Beacon might be just the nature reserve for you. It's only 4 miles from Walsall town centre and, being one of the highest points in the West Midlands, offers spectacular panoramic views. All in all, on a good day, you can see at least 11 counties from here. Over here, Worcester and South Birmingham, and behind me, Staffordshire and Shropshire, with Wales stretching beyond it. It's also the high point of the Beacon Way long distance footpath, as well as a popular spot for enjoying shorter strolls. The focal point of Bar Beacon is its War Memorial, one of Walsall's most recognisable landmarks. A Heritage Lottery Fund project, Raising the Bar, was launched in 2012 with the celebration of the Queen's Diamond Jubilee and with the lighting of the beacon. The project was called Raising the Bar, and its aim was to restore the memorial and other heritage features, as well as community engagement.
All over the country, thousands of beacons are being lit at 10:15 tonight. It'll be our turn to light ours, and hopefully from here we'll be able to see all of the other beacons lit up in the landscape around us, because we've got a pretty good 360 degree view from up here. Raising the Bar is a project that is going to run for 3 years, and it's about to start imminently. We've received a grant from the Heritage Lottery Fund to restore the heritage features on Bar Beacon, so the War Memorial, the flagpole and the historic plantation behind me.
We've come out to Bar Beacon because it's the nearest place for us to come and join in the celebrations, and my sister-in-law's bought me.
And we've been coming here all our lives. It's one beautiful spot to come to.
I really want the Queen to reign 5 more years.
Yeah.
To beat Queen Victoria.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that it's better for us.
Yes.
And it's in our lifetime. We might not get anything like this again.
Throughout history, fires have been lit on hills to send messages, warn of danger and commemorate significant events.
Tonight what we've done, we've been part of an international series of beacons that have been across the Commonwealth and across the UK, and I'm absolutely delighted that Bar Beacon's been involved. It's the first time in many, many decades that we've been involved in an event like this, and we've lit the beacon, we've had some fantastic music, and I think about the 500 people who attended have really enjoyed the event to celebrate the Queen's Diamond Jubilee.
Beacon's fires have also been lit to warn of the attack of the Spanish Armada in 1588 and to celebrate Queen Victoria's Golden and Diamond Jubilees during the 19th century. The beacons created a chain of fires on hilltops right across the country. It's thought that Bar Beacon means a hill used for fire signals, because Bar is Celtic for hill or Old English for summit. One of the first tasks of Raising the Bar was the restoration of this war memorial, which dates back to 1933 and is made of Portland stone.
The copper that was on the roof, that was unfortunately stolen 3 or 4 times, so it was covered in tarpaulin. So it didn't look in a very good state, really. And also the stonework which was worked on was weathered away, so there was like the water getting in there, it freezing, it'd break up the stonework. The topograph, which is basically a map, centred around Barbican, looking around, seeing all the points around that had been stolen and removed. So we're having a new one put in there. It's going to be new railings in there as well. So it looked totally refurbished, but still in keeping with the heritage of the building.
The roof is completely rotten on top of the dome. What we're having to do now is strip off all the timber work and replace it section for section exactly how it came off. And we have to replace all the structural elements and the fixings to it so that by the time the roof coverings go back on, obviously we put in a robust structure back in place.
As you can see, the timber now is completely shot. These are the original fixings, the bolts, which we're actually cutting off, and we're going to put new stainless steel bolts in there, which their lifespan could be anything up to 100 years.
The main challenge is the roof and choosing a material that wasn't going to be as a target for metal thieves in the future, which was one of the reasons for the choice of VM zinc.
It's important that we are restoring the memorial because it's one of the iconic areas in the West Midlands. It's really high, it's important for local people of Walsall, and also it was built some 80 years ago to remember the people in the First World War, so it's important to remember them and for current people use the site and also future generations. We have a lot of school kids up here doing different projects, so them to respect the area and respect the area for the future. So if it looks that it's well kept, looked after, and people are concerned and feel a lot for the area, then in the future hopefully that will continue.
After 9 months of hard work by various contractors and stonemasons and roofers, we've reached the completion of the actual restoration work of the part of the project, and now we're moving on with the community involvement side. We've actually got a real sort of focus for getting people up here now because they can see the work that's been done so far. The memorial, especially on a day like today, looks absolutely wonderful in the glorious sunshine, almost like a beacon on the hill. And we've had a lot of positive comments from visitors and site users.
I'm very impressed with it. Yes, yeah. We've been up time before and it's really been dilapidated, you know. I heard about all the trouble with the thieves and now it looks very nice.
The roof used to be made of copper, but due to theft and vandalism, through raising the bar, we were able to restore the dome with zinc. It looks just the same, only it's less valuable and, we hope, less tempting to thieves. The metal is also marked with Smart Water, a special coating that means if someone tries to sell it for scrap, the police will know it's stolen from here. And we've got CCTV covering the site too. Under the dome is this central plinth, featuring plaques commemorating the dedication and rededication of the memorial, and a mounted direction finder or topographic disc. And you can use this and our mobile phone app to help you spot and identify features in the surrounding landscape. Barbican is one of the few remaining examples of lowland heath in the region. It was once part of a huge area of heathland that stretched from Sutton Park to Cannock Chase. And you can discover the plants and animals that make heathland their home on the 2 mile circular nature trail. You can also use the mobile phone app to guide you through the trail with the choice of a wildlife or heritage trail to complete. During spring and summer, it'll lead you through purple blankets of heather, golden flowering gorse, and flower-rich meadows alive with butterflies, mining bees and other heathland wildlife. There's usually some interesting bird life to look out for too, with ravens, buzzards and kestrels all being regular visitors. Our rangers are experts at identifying and handling wildlife. Don't try this at home.
Barbican is made up of lots of different habitats, places where wildlife can live. And one of the main habitats that you'll find here is heathland. In this part of the country, there was a huge expanse of heathland. As well as Barbican, you'll also find heathland down the road to the east in Sutton Park, then to the north at Shire Oak Park and on Brownhills Common, and a little further on Cannock Chase. At one time, all of these sites were linked together in a large area of lowland heath.
As we explore Barbican, we're going to keep a lookout for the plants and animals that make heathland their home.
And it's not just heathland species. You can find animals and plants in other important habitats here too. We have mixed woodland with lots of different tree species, meadows, hedgerows and amenity grass areas, all of which are home to many interesting and different types of wildlife. This is a really nice little bee that I've just got out of this foxglove. It's one of the common bumblebees that you'll see in your garden, and it's actually called the garden bumblebee. And this bee is a male, and I can tell he's a male because he's got quite narrow back legs, and that's because the males don't need broad legs for carrying pollen because they basically don't do any work or carry any pollen. So I know that he won't be able to sting me because male bees don't have a sting. They just don't have the body parts. Bees are in decline, and we think that it probably is largely to do with pesticide use. Areas like this, which are managed sympathetically with nature and surrounded by urban areas, are absolutely perfect for bees because urban areas don't tend to have the heavy pesticide use that agricultural areas do. So it's a bit of a haven for them. So it's a great site for a great little bee. And I'll show you that he's definitely male. And won't sting me. One of the animals that you're not likely to see if you come up to Barbican during the daytime is a bat, and the reason for this is that they're nocturnal. You're more likely to see them at around dusk during the summer months, and because of this, every year on Barbican we organise special bat walks. One of the species bats that you are likely to see up here on Barbican is the common pipistrelle, and I have one here to show you. This is Macy, and she is about 2 weeks old, and she's pretty small. But even when she's fully grown, she'll still fit inside a matchbox. And that's because the pipistrelle is the UK's smallest species of bat. But here on Barbican, we've also got the UK's largest species of bat, which is the noctule. Now, Mesa here can see about as well as I can, which at night is not very well. So when she's fully grown and released, she'll find her way around at night by echolocating, using sound to see. Now, Mesa's going to be fed up and released, and I have a special license to handle her. But bats are a protected species throughout Europe.
And of course, there are lots of species that we could have mentioned, including bluebells, buzzards, green woodpeckers, great spotted woodpeckers, mammals including the grey squirrel, rabbit, wood mice, and common shrew. So keep a lookout.
We know that Barbican was used by Stone Age man because a Neolithic mace head has been found by archaeologists. And Roman coins have been discovered here too. Our recent archaeological excavation involved local school children and volunteers from the community. We found evidence of 12th century ridge and furrow farming, and it was a unique opportunity for people to take part in an actual dig.
We've been invited by Walsall Council to come and undertake some excavations for them. There's been a programme of archaeological work done over a good few years now. So there was a desk-based assessment done where they collected all the map evidence and the cartographic evidence. And then that was followed up by geophysical survey. And then there was some test pitting, so just metre squares. We've had the opportunity now, thanks to the Heritage Lottery funding, to come back and open up some bigger areas and see what we can find.
It's one of the highest points in the West Midlands, and wherever you get a high point, you tend to get human activity. Even if it's just farming or agricultural, at least it's sort of built up a bit of a picture of the site and and what's gone on in the past.
Well, this is a piece of clay pipe that you've just found here, a nice bit of stem from the clay pipe.
Good, that's excellent, isn't it? That's another nice piece of Victorian pottery.
Victorian pottery?
Yes, yeah, very good.
We have walked very far to get to here so we can do the archaeological dig, and we're going to find as much stuff as we possibly can.
Our school, Blackwood School, has been involved in the Raising the Bar project in association with the council. And when we heard about the dig, the whole school was absolutely delighted to be invited.
It's really cool doing an archaeological dig. Just digging through, I was about to put in the bin where I noticed that I had found a piece of pottery.
They're mostly finding finds which would probably date back over the last sort of 100 years or so, bits of brick and tile, pottery, glass, and one of the little boys did find a coin, which is very unusual, a coin from the probably late Second World War coin, 3p piece, which certainly surprised everybody because they weren't expecting that at all.
This is sort of 18th, 19th century, a storage jar. So it's glazed internally, it's designed to hold a liquid. They haven't bothered glazing it on the outside, glaze is expensive. So we think that this is probably made up ground associated with the landscaping, potentially to do with the war memorial itself. So that's actually really quite nice in that we've got some nice dating material. And to go with it, we have a bit of engineering brick, a much smaller fragment. So really this is essentially Black Country industry, which is really rather nice given where we are.
These days, however, Bar Beacon is more space age than stone age, as it's a popular spot for stargazing. Used regularly by the Warsaw Astronomical Society, it's been designated a dark sky discovery site, which means that it's one of the best places in the region to observe the night sky due to reduced light pollution. Other activities on Bar Beacon include regular health walks, organised by Warsaw Council's Walk On programme. Each week, trained volunteers lead groups of people around parks and countryside sites across the borough.
Walking is great, it's free, it's open all the time. Bar Beacon's a beautiful park. You can walk in a group or on your own, and it's accessible all times. It's a great place to walk. There's lots of benefits to walking. It's good health-wise, so it reduces your risk of diabetes, it gives you a healthy heart, it also helps with anxiety and depression, and also you can lose weight, it makes you stronger, helps with balance for when you get older, so there's lots and lots of benefits to walking.
I think Bar Beacon itself, it's so open, very cold in the winter, but wrap up and you don't notice it. In the summer, you see the changes. It's lovely. We love it. Yes.
I decided, I wanted the healthier lifestyle. So I decided to eat healthy and incorporate exercise, which is walking. And it's done me the power of good. It's, fantastic. I feel fantastic.
Our local primary school runs a forest school programme on the Beacon, giving children an opportunity to learn outside the classroom and enjoy the natural environment.
Welcome to our forest school.
Welcome, children. I would like you this week to have a think about something that you have enjoyed at forest school, or a forest school rule that you remember.
Forest school is a method of learning outside the classroom, where children of all abilities are able to explore, identify risks and manage them, work as a team, support each other, and use creative talents. That
I remember from forest school that look but not touch the fungi.
Good girl.
I have a rule in Forest School, and that is to always help others.
Forest School came from a Scandinavian concept, really, where people spend a lot more time outside in the natural environment, and it's part of the education and progression that people start at an early age. So less academic stuff in classrooms and people actually learning skills outside in the environment. So starting really early, so threes and fours actually getting out, playing with tools and fire, seeing these practical things actually happen. Whereas over here we've got a bit of a sterilised environment where if it's not in a classroom, it's almost not seen as education.
Remember, at Forest School we look after ourselves and other people. Now we've got some extra adults today, so we need to show them where to go.
So this is so holistic, it's open to every pupil, that an even playing field. It doesn't matter if they're not brilliant at spelling or reading, they're not at a disadvantage. And it's quite nice to see them come out and sort of excel in different areas with the practical things and the tools and the exploring.
So keep it and then turn it.
I'd like to say a very big thank you to the Heritage Lottery Fund and Walsall Council for providing the funding and the opportunity to take part in Forest School. Without that, Blackwood School would have no Forest School. And although the funding is now coming to an end, we intend to carry on and roll out Forest School within other year groups as well.
Thank you for visiting our Forest School.
Bands on the Beacon Music Festivals have been hugely popular and we'll try to carry on this tradition in years to come.
So ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Bands on the Beacon.
This is a great opportunity for local bands to be showcased. This year we must have had 100 bands apply, and we've tried to take bands from mainly from the locality, but obviously we'll go further afield. Last year we had somebody from St Neots, this year we've got somebody coming up from Brighton. So we're starting to become not just regionally significant, but maybe even nationally significant.
Music is hopefully sort of a broad range from, we've got Shadows tribute bands, so from the 60s, local bands, soul, blues, mainly local ones, but also from further afield.
So ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for your very own, the truly wonderful Let's Rock, Rick Gale!
The best band in the world.
From
I'm going to
Warsaw.
Take over.
A local band from Warsaw.
Yeah.
Just putting our music out there. All our songs free to download and stuff, so it's all good.
We've got a really unique site. I mean, it's it could be like the Midlands Glastonbury, because we're on a hill, we've got fantastic views. And we're dead in the centre of the country. It's actually easier to get here than it is to Glastonbury.
He said it's gonna be a better week. She said it's gonna make you stronger, you and me. He said I'm sorry.
We've had a great time.
It's been a lovely time, it's been great. Bands have been fantastic. Everybody's enjoyed it, so fantastic.
We've had a wonderful time, thank you.
As usual, we've had a fantastic time.
We came last year as well.
I came last year. By accident, because I didn't really know it was on.
Definitely come again next year.
Yeah.
Definitely
my plans for next year now. Now we've experienced it. Looking forward to next year.
It's exceptional. I've played festivals in the West Midlands that have been dreadfully organised and there's been no one there, and this, it's incredible what you've managed to achieve. But at least I still have you, they have each other. And nothing else will matter, they think these things last forever. And sometimes they do, so hold.
It's been absolutely fantastic. First class, even the weather couldn't stop it. Last year was good, but this year's even better.
Looking back then, Geoff, what do you think are some of the biggest achievements of the Raising the Bar project?
Well, I think to actually get the restoration work done on the memorial was one of the key aims. But from that, we've attracted a great deal of community interest into the project. There's been an events programme and a community engagement programme, and they've worked hand in hand to actually bring people onto the site. There's been quite a few family-orientated events, such as Bands on the Beacon, which have brought up lots of families, generations, grandparents to little toddlers, running around, listening to music, enjoying the space. But one of the things that has arisen out of the project is a little remembrance service involving local school children and ex-servicemen. And every Friday for the last 4 years, they've been coming together at Remembrance Weekend, coming together and carrying out just a little wreath-laying ceremony. And it makes me choke up, actually, because we've got the flag flying and we've got the last post. And just a nice little ceremony where we've got those generations of children and ex-servicemen coming together and, you know, literally walking up and laying wreaths together. And that's just a really sort of positive thing to see. And the more and more things that happen like that, the more interest we're going to get in the site, and the more people are hopefully going to support it and help look after it.
We now hope that the Raising the Bar project legacy will be the continuation of various activities, but being led by the community with the support of Barbican Trust, the landowners, and Walsall Council, who manage the site on behalf of the Trust. Barbican remains open for everyone to enjoy, but also to respect.